April 27, 1982. That date is forever etched into the hearts of the people of Seoul, who are around to witness what is now referred to as the worst killing spree incident in known history. On that day, children became fatherless, women became widows, men, widowers, and entire families were wiped out. The events of April 27, 1982 left the whole of South Korea, and indeed the entire world, stunned. South Korea was in mourning after a night of blood-curdling horror. That night, 57 people were found dead, and it was all the work of one man, Woo Bang-kun. Woo Bang-kun was a Korean police officer born on February 24, 1955. Bang-kun had previously served with the South Korean Marines for a period that lasted up till 1978. By 1980, Bang-kun decided to join the National Police in Busan. He was first transferred to a local police station in Gyeonggi. Afterwards, he settled in the village of Toreongni in December 1981. Not much is known of Bang-kun's private life and upbringing, and following his murderous spree on April 27, 1982, not much about his private life was revealed. He seemed like a normal guy who was just happy to serve his country in the police force, but it turned out that was far from the truth. What we can now deduce in hindsight is that Woo Bang-kun was battling with his own personal demons, devious blood-sucking demons right from the pits of hell. Only a man who was as disturbed as the biblical legion could have perpetrated the magnitude of evil that Bang-kun unleashed in Seoul. April 26, 1982 was supposed to be a normal afternoon for Bang-kun. He was having a regular afternoon nap in his home when he was woken by his girlfriend, Chun Mao-sun. Mao-sun did not mean to wake up Bang-kun. She only intended to swat a fly that was lying on his chest, but of course, she ended waking him up. What she didn't know was that like the proverbial flap of the butterfly's wing, she had triggered a sequence of events that would end up in the most catastrophic proportions. If she had only known, she might have let the fly have its way on Bang-kun's chest. But really, no one can blame Chun Mao-sun. She had no clue what was about to happen. Bang-kun woke from his sleep red in anger. Who knows what troubling sleep visions he might have had this afternoon. Whatever he had dreamed, his girlfriend's attempt to swat a fly on his chest only aggravated his now disturbed spirit. In a fit of anger, Bang-kun dashed out of the house and made his way to the police station. By 4 p.m, he checked himself in for duty. That was when the demons got to work on him. Bang-kun drowned one bottle of alcohol, then another, and another. By 7 p.m, he was completely drunk. The drunk police officer managed to make his way back home at 7:30 p.m. He met his girlfriend Mao-sun still at home. He saw red. Now under the control of the alcohol in his veins, he went into an angry rage. He punched his girlfriend and slapped her across her face till she fell to the floor, and then he kicked her repeatedly. Like a scene from a wrestling match, he proceeded to grab a piece of furniture and smashed it right on his girlfriend. As if that wasn't enough, Bang-kun made his way back to the police station, headed straight to the armory. The other police officers at the station were at a meeting, so Bang-kun's movements were unnoticed. In the armory, Bang-kun assembled a small arsenal for himself, two M2 carbines, 7 hand grenades, and 180 rounds of ammunition. He then exited the police station unnoticed. By this time, his inner demons were in full control. At 9:30 p.m, Bang-kun, while walking through a marketplace in the village of Toreongni, began to open fire at the passerbys. His girlfriend Mao-sun, still sore from the brutal bearing she had received, heard the gunshots in the marketplace, which was not far from their house. She went out to investigate what was happening, but what she saw must have left her shell-shocked. It was her boyfriend in full terrorist mode. The now depraved Bang-kun didn't slow down when he saw his girlfriend. In fact, he shot her and wounded her. But this was just the beginning of the carnage. Bang-kun went on to the post office in the nearby village of Gyeonggi. He met 3 phone operators and shot each of them to death. Then he cut off the telephone lines to ensure that no one called for emergency services. He then went on from village to village, killing at will. He came up with a sickening trap. Using his privilege as a uniformed police officer, he gained access into people's homes. Once in their homes, the demented cop opened fire, killing all the inhabitants of the home. He did this from village to village. In the village of Unge, he killed 18 people. In Pyeongchang, he killed 24. In one home, he first asked a 16-year-old boy to get him a drink from the grocery. When the boy returned, Bang-kun shot him and his entire family. In another place, he killed an entire family using a grenade, blowing them into unrecognizable bits and pieces. Wubong Khan went on this killing rampage for 8 hours, moving from village to village. The police were onto him after they had been alerted 1 hour into Boom Khan's killing spree. By the early hours of April 27, Boom Khan now had only 2 hand grenades on him. He had used the rest of the ammunition on innocent villagers. With the police closing in on him, Boom Khan hid in the farmhouse of a 68-year-old Seo-in Su. Boom Khan took him and his family captive, and as the police had surrounded and were moving in on him, Boom Khan released the fuses of the grenades. He died instantly, along with the 3 of his hostages. The 68-year-old Seo-in Su managed to survive, but not without sustaining serious injuries. By the end of Wubong Khan's 8-hour killing spree, 57 people were dead and 35 were injured. We would never really know what turned Boom Khan into the devil himself, as he died before he had the chance to tell his tale, but not without ripping apart the hearts of hundreds of people who had lost their loved ones for absolutely no reason. But thankfully, the killer that is Boom Khan is no more.